Hi, I'm Debbie Moraes, and this is Legal Matters, the program that's designed to address the critical issues, some controversial issues that are facing consumers and businesses today, legal information, practical solutions, and straight talk about a wide variety of topics that affect your work and home life. In some of our recent programs, we've addressed business startup issues, some things about healthcare reform, flood damage, and also the rising tide of scams, hopefully that you will in hopes that you will avoid them. We try to provide some information about how you would look for some legitimate assistance. And today, another important topic for many of you, that being real estate. The acronym is RESPA, Real Estate Settlement Procedures Act, and it's designed to help consumers not be taken advantage of. Today we have our legal eagles, our legal experts, to help us wend our way through that. Jackie Grasso and David Bazar from Odette Bazar Cadero Grasso Law Firm in East Providence. Thank you for joining us once again.
Thank you.
And let's delve into it. What is the broad brush stroke? What is RESPA about?
RESPA is was a federal statute that was designed in 1974. The main purpose was to avoid scams. Okay, kickbacks. It's basically a consumer protection statute. So it mandates that banks have to do certain things when somebody applies for a loan. It's applicable to homeowners, not commercial loans. So individual consumers, banks do not have, commercial loans do not come under the RESPA statute.
So to fit this into the bigger picture of some of the things we've talked about, we talked a while back about the credit card changes. That was a Consumer Protection Act for the most part, designed to protect consumers. RESPA was designed for the same thing. And how does it fit in with our recent conversations? Well, you had your rising tide come into your basement.
People are taking home loans.
Yeah. Now, this does affect both refinances and home loans and if you were to buy a new house. So it affects both aspects of real estate.
I think in recent segments, you also mentioned, too, that it applied to not just single family, but up to four family homes. Four homes, is that true as part of RESPA, or is that considered now commercial?
It can't be more than a four-family
house. Four family.
They talk about multi-family house or single-family house.
That somebody lives in.
If it's your residence.
Yes, primary residence.
Exactly.
Okay.
Now,
you
can't have as your primary residence, a 30-unit apartment.
Yeah, that would be a commercial loan.
That becomes commercial.
Which does not come under the Act.
Right.
Yeah.
Apart from you not being taken advantage of, it's also, as I understand it, supposed to help you become more savvy shoppers. Do most people have access, quick access to how to become a good, savvy shopper when it comes to settlement companies and financing and refinancing?
At the time an individual applies for a loan application, the bank has a few requirements under the statute. The first is they have to be given a special information booklet, and that has been updated when the Act has recently been updated with changes in January,
right.
I think.
That was part of the Obama administration.
Yeah, the amendments.
So that booklet contains some information regarding various real estate settlement services. It also gives you a list of definitions, because quite often people have no idea what a survey is. Some people don't know certain taxes, like flood tax.
Right.
So it explains all of that. That has to be given to the borrowers. They also have to be given what's called a GFE, a good faith estimate. And that has to detail all of the proposed settlement costs.
Right.
And lastly, they have to be given a mortgage service disclosure statement stating who is going to be servicing the loan.
Right. As you know, you borrow money from one bank or lender, and it ends up with another. And part of what has to happen in the disclosure is what is the percentage of loans that this bank that you're dealing with ends up keeping versus what they send to another servicing company. They sell them. This really even goes back to our discussion when we talked about the subprime market and some of that stuff, where banks would package mortgages together and then sell them off as an investment. So you need to know, and part of what you're being told is, what is the likelihood that I'm going to be paying my loan to the bank down the street, or am I mailing it to some company across the country?
And you'd care about that, because, so what if my loan is sold off? If it's not affecting the amount I have to pay or whatever, why would I care?
You know, and people always ask me that when we were doing these closings and we'd be going through these forms. And there's an upside and a downside. The downside is that if your loan is with some big company that's across the country, you can't go knock on the door and say, wait a minute, I got a question here, there's a problem. And some of what got changed in this act, the amendment, does help address that.
Yeah, you have to be given notice as to who's going to be servicing the loan. The other thing the booklet tells you is what your rights are with regard to choosing real estate appraisers, choosing
title attorneys,
settlement companies. Sometimes they have just settlement companies, not title companies.
What's the difference?
Sometimes they'll just hire an attorney just to do the closing.
Right.
Versus a title company doing the closing. Sometimes the title companies, they'll do the closing because there might be an attorney that works for the title company.
We can talk a little bit about what some of the recent amendments were designed to correct. You would get a bank that might be advertising a very low interest rate. Someone comes into the bank and says, okay, I'm going to sign up for that. In the meantime, the bank says to that person, you have to use our title attorney, pay this X number of dollars for an appraisal, and on down the line, where the bank was actually getting money back from these companies.
The kickbacks.
And this was designed to avoid it. Transparency.
Mm-hmm.
You know what you're paying and who you're paying. And in Rhode Island, we've always had the rule that the buyer was entitled to pick their own title attorney and have that attorney write the title insurance, which is a good portion of the cost of a closing. So this RESPA amendment was designed to say that you have to show everybody up front who's getting what and eliminate those kickbacks so that if you're getting a 5% interest rate, you're not paying the 5% plus $5,000 more that the lender's getting from someone else.
So we need to worry about this from the start of the loan application.
Exactly.
Through to what they might consider to be an escrow, what your closing costs are, what are the other issues? I mean, there's a host of possible places where you could be done in or at least have to be wary of what you're going to be paying in advance.
They do have to comply with the statute with regard to escrows. So, for instance, I have a mortgage, I get a escrow statement once a year. The reason I get it once a year is because they have to comply with the RESPA statute. They are required to give you a written statement telling you how much was paid towards taxes, if there was any interest, and if you're over your cushion, so to speak, they actually have to give you money back. So every
right.
once in a while, I'll get my escrow statement along with a check saying, yep, we don't need all this money, you know, keep that money, here's the money
right.
back.
So that everyone understands, the escrow is when you pay your mortgage, principal and interest, it can include a payment for taxes and perhaps insurance.
Mm-hmm.
And if the bank is collecting your money to pay those things, this act requires that bank or mortgage company to do an annual estimate of what they need to pay those bills, and they're entitled to collect enough money to make sure when the bill comes due, they have it there to pay. They can't collect a cushion that's larger than a certain percentage, 1.5 or whatever the number is of what they need in order to pay those bills. So as Jackie was saying, if they've collected too much, they send you money back. When you see a payment rate change in a fixed rate mortgage where there's escrow, it's usually the amount being collected for the escrow that's changed. Taxes have gone up, they need to collect more money for taxes, that type of thing.
Oddly enough, my property in Florida, the value went down, so my taxes went down, and I actually got a check from the mortgage company. I never thought I'd see that happen. Yeah.
Right. And strangely enough, in Rhode Island, when your real estate value goes down, your taxes don't because the amount that they charge for the rate per thousand goes up.
Yeah.
That's nice, too, to be aware of. Do most people who are starting to refinance, are they, because they've already gone through one set of mortgages, are most of them really aware of all of these potential pitfalls? Or is it still something that we have to buyer beware?
I think this buyer beware.
Still.
Who really reads the fine print on a mortgage? When you sit and close on a mortgage, myself included, there's a whole forest of paper. So who really reads the fine print? Does anybody ever explain to you what is RESPA? What is a bank required to do to service the loan? How much can I be charged in closing costs? Not many people know that. Thus, it's probably the best thing is to bring in your own attorney when you close on a loan.
So you as a lawyer might be handling the application portion of it, that settlement portion of it.